Hi, friends. It's me, Suze Pratt, your holistic stylist, coming to you today with a rebroadcast of one of my Sophia's Emporiums that was originally published on July 4th, 2016. Now, for those of you that know, see, I'm a hairdresser, and I'm actually a nationally accredited board certified hair colorist, if anybody gives a shit. But I'll tell you what, in my business, of course, you know, there's a lot of gossip, and I'm more about the gospel truth. So I want to ask you this. Have you ever felt like you're being lied to? Now, I've had this book on the shelf for years, and when we first read it, it seemed so, you know, just over the top. And people used to call it conspiracy theory, of course. And, you know, in my industry, you're never supposed to talk about sex, politics, or religion. But what do people gossip about all day long? Now, that's where your buddy Suze is different. I've always talked about things I'm talking to you guys about now. So I never really did fit in the hairdresser club because I like to expose the lies. So I want to share screen and take you to the show of the day. And at the time I did title this Independence versus Delusion. How funny is it? Do not share your own with these people. Good grief. And of course, we're coming to you live through the Conscious Consumer Network. So, happy Independence Day, everybody. And of course, my name is Suze Pratt. I'm your holistic stylist. And, you know, I've had a pretty serious last three shows, if any of you guys have been following along, where I actually exposed something concerning the vaccines that I don't really believe had ever been brought to the table. So it was pretty intense. But anyhow, I'm going to try to bring you a lighter, funnier side to your buddy Suze today. And of course, I want to stress that I will only do that without damage to my integrity as a aspiring journalist. So I have my facts ready to go today, but there will be a fun, you know, there'll be a couple fun surprises. Okay, so I got a story real quick. I was at the bank yesterday, you know, scraping every penny together to pay the mortgage on time and, you know, blah, blah, blah. And as each person stepped up into line, you know, they said the same thing, and it reminded me exactly of those little links we share where it will document that each journalist or reporter in mainstream media will say the same dumbass thing, right? So the party line at the bank was, well, you know, what are your plans for the holiday weekend? And of course, you know, I'm not into that, but anyhow, of course they want to know that because it all bears witness to how much money they're going to be spending, I guess, or how much shit they're going to be blowing up, which, you know, works good either way you go. But of course, I like to tell them that I'm really not involved in those rituals. And of course, they know me and I didn't speak to them when I go inside to do my banking. You see, that's old school. And my grandma worked in a bank. So when I was a kid, I'd go to work with her and she worked in the vault across from the vault with all the money in it, you know, and this is back in the early 70s. So yeah, we won't be participating in the madness, and we sit right out on the front porch at the big yellow house and watch it all go down. And of course, you know, this year I'll be there with my movie camera, so should be very interesting. I wanted to start with a little book I have today that I'll be using through the show. And this book is called You're Being Lied To: The Disinformation Guide to Media Distortion, Historical Whitewashes, and Cultural Myths. And I came across this book right when it was published, so I will want to share that story with you as well. But I can remember when I brought it into the hair shop and put it on the bookshelf. I mean, people were really upset by this book. So this was back in the year 2000, and now that it's 16 years later, I don't really think anybody's going to be too terribly upset. I think what it should do is confirm spirit for you guys, right? Okay, I wanted to start out with the definition of freedom for you guys. And it says, freedom, the word for whose contents many modern women fight, comes from a men's only ritual among ancient German tribes. Two clans who'd been mowing each other's members down made peace by invoking the god Frida and giving up Frida-ing, so to speak, a few haunches of meat or a pile of animal hides to mollify the enemy and let the matter drop. As for the last word in feminism has won freedom for women, women originally meant nothing more than a man's wife. And that's the Anglo-Saxons pronounced it with men or wife men. So it was W-I-F-M-A-N. And so I thought that was a great way to start out, because as a freedom seeker and a traveler on this path, I mean, of course, my entire life I pushed out of that box to acquire a little more freedom, what I perceived as independence, because of course I had come from something less independent, you see. And another thing that I thought was very, very interesting in this book is a quote, and here it is. The loss of liberty in general would soon follow the suppression of the liberty of the press, for it is an essential branch of liberty, so perhaps it is the best preservative of the whole. And this was spoken by a gentleman by the name of John Peter Zenger, and that was back in November. of 1733. Now, this dude survived, of course, because he was a printer and a publisher. And that was a huge thing in those days. I think it's so cool now that all of us, if we just put our minds to it, can print and publish also. Because that is the only chance that we have when you read this story and you get the background to what really went down in journalism. Now, somebody asked me recently, well, who wrote this book? And of course, there are so many contributors to this book that really all you can say is that it was edited by a man named Russ Kick. So, I'm going to read to you a little about our buddy Russ. And this is the introduction to the book. It says, we are being lied to in many ways. For the purposes of this book, the definition of lie is an elastic one. Sometimes it means an outright falsehood told in order to deceive people and advance the agenda of the liar. Or it can be a lie of omission, in which the crucial part of the story that we're not being told is more important than the parts we know. Sometimes the lie can be something untrue that the speaker thinks is true, otherwise known as misinformation, as opposed to disinformation, which is something untrue that the speaker knows is untrue. In yet other cases, particular erroneous beliefs are so universal motives. It's just something that everyone knows. Sometimes, in fact, the lie might be the outmoded dominant paradigm in a certain field. A related type of lie, a meta lie, perhaps, occurs when certain institutions arrogantly assume that they have all the answers. These institutions then try to manipulate us with a swarm of smaller individual lies. As a wise soul once noted, all you have to do is find a single white crow to disprove the statement that all crows are black. And of course, these cases are in the minority. But basically, the pieces in this book show that the received wisdom, the common knowledge, is often wrong. Well, then what's right? That's a much, much more complicated question, and the answers are elusive. Hopefully, we'll all spend our lives pursuing them. But the first step is to realize that the answers that are being handed to us on a silver platter, or perhaps more often, shoved down our throats, are often incorrect, incomplete, and usually serve the interests of the people promoting those so-called answers. And that's where this book comes in. So dive in at any point, and you'll see that this book's title is deadly accurate. What you do about it is up to you. And this is by Russ Kick. I thought that was beautifully worded. Okay, now I got my first little video for you guys, and I definitely have some comments after we run it, of course. But what I will say before you see it is that I know you know that we already realize that if you participate in any given subject, it's all about how you do it. So Let's just go ahead and do this. This is a video called North Americans Leaders Summit, and it's by Dan Dix on Press for Truth.
This is Dan Dix here reporting for Press for Truth, coming at you here today in Ottawa on Parliament Hill. We're here to cover the 2016 North American Leaders Summit, where Barack Obama and Enrique Peña Nieto are set to arrive here to have a meeting with Justin Trudeau. And already it's been quite the security nightmare. I've had my bag searched twice now, been patted down twice already just for being in the area. And, you know, it's funny. Local Ottawa residents were polled asking if they would want to come down here downtown today to welcome the arrival of the President of the United States. And overwhelmingly, they responded, 93% of local Ottawa residents said they don't care whatsoever about the arrival of Barack Obama. And you could see that. There is virtually no one here, essentially. And maybe that's because they're waking up to the fact that this whole hope and change mantra was all really just a lie. Or maybe they're not waking up to that fact because they seem to have bought it from Justin Trudeau, who was promising the same thing but not exactly delivering. Now, it's interesting to note that the last time this summit took place in Canada was 10 years ago. And back then, it wasn't called the North American Leaders Summit. It was referred to as the Security and Prosperity Partnership. They've since rebranded it to the North American Leaders Summit. But back then, when we were covering that event, there were hundreds, if not thousands of people there protesting these trade deals that are leading towards this North American Union. We documented extensively the agent provocateur situation that took place there and exposed it in our film, The Nation's Deathbed, and also United We Fall. Fast forward 10 years. Here on Parliament Hill, 2016, I have not seen one protester. I have not seen any kind of a presence of anybody, essentially, except for a whole lot of police officers and some various alternative media, not even alternative media, just mainstream news outlets are here, and that's it. So it is a bit of a sad state of affairs that people are not concerned with this, and they should be. Today, they are discussing this move towards lifting the visa requirements for Mexicans to travel into Canada, and Enrique's going to lift this ban on exporting Canadian beef, and everything's good. We're moving towards more free trade, working together. Really, folks, if the Brexit, Britain's exit from Europe wasn't, an obvious sign to you that people are not interested in joining in with these unions, and people are starting to see that globalization essentially is just the centralization of power into fewer and fewer hands, well, perhaps people should realize that that's the key, that's the case with the formation of the North American Union through these various trade deals that are happening over the years. It's all made for more good, but really it's all bringing us, uniting us under the umbrella of an eventual NAU. So that's why we're here. Stick around. We're going to have more videos coming out soon on our YouTube channel. I just wanted to quickly give you an update, let you know we are here. We are on the grounds documenting this one. So stay tuned, guys. We're going to have more video reports coming very soon to pressfortruth.ca.
Alrighty then. So nobody shows up. And we already know that if they did, maybe they would get harassed, just like our friend here, who I have been watching a lot of his work. He would be the only English-speaking guy that was documenting the Bilderberg conference. And so that's how I found out about this channel. So I've got a question for everybody. Do you think anybody would show up if all of a sudden people figured out that this America place that I'm, trending today isn't really a republic? Maybe that has something to do with media too, but we'll find out as we go forward. So We're back to the book, page 27. And this chapter, the name of it is called Journalists Doing Somersaults, Self-Censorship and the Rise of the Corporate Media State. And this dissertation is by Norman Solomon. Okay. I wanted to bring this to you in the life charting timeline fashion that I'm so comfortable with. And we're starting out right here. Many of us grew up with tales of journalistic courage dating back to colonial days. John Peter Zenger's ability to challenge the British Crown with unyielding articles drew strength from the fact that he was a printer and publisher. Writing in the New York Weekly, a periodical burned several times by the public hangman, Zenger asserted in November 1733, the loss of liberty in general would soon follow the suppression of the liberty of the press, for it is an essential branch of liberty, so perhaps it is the best preservative of the whole. You know, these days, where there's a little bit of, you know, gossip or rumor about state censorship actually being in the land of the, the home of the brave and the free, right? I mean, how does this actually work? And, you know, one thing that he brought up is, we might wonder how Zenger would fare in, you know, things of today's workplace, especially if he chose to denounce as excessive the power of the conglomerate of providing the paycheck. All right. So, here's a book that first appeared in 1983 called The Media Monopoly. And its author, Ben Bagdakian, explains, 50 corporations dominated most of every mass medium. With each new edition, that number kept dropping. Okay. In 1987, it went down to 29 media firms. In 1990, it went down to 23. 1992, down to 14. And 10 by the year 1997. We might start to imagine that maybe this was foreshadowing to the events that were set in place to occur after the year 2000. That's what I want to bring to the forefront. Okay. Now, at that time, they say, while seeming to be a gateway to a vast cyber galaxy, AOL's favorite links will remain overwhelmingly corporate friendly within a virtual cul-de-sac. So, here's why we want to talk about that. America Online is combining with already number one Time Warner shortly after this. And the new firm, AOL Time Warner, would have more to lose than any other corporation if a movement grew to demand antitrust action against media conglomerates. Okay. Something that Bagdakian points out is the power and influence of the dominant companies are understated by counting then as six. So we get all the way down to six after the year 2000. He says they are intertwined. They unstop in each other. They cooperate in joint media ventures. And among themselves, they divide profits for some of the most widely viewed programs on television, cable, and movies. We may not like the nation's gigantic media firms, but right now they don't care much what we think. A strong antitrust movement aimed at the big six could change such indifference in a hurry. Very interesting. Okay. So now what we're gonna, we're gonna talk about this real quick, okay? So you see that all these dedicated journalists and media people, I mean, back then, can you imagine if they spoke out and the way things were being grabbed up and taken over, they might not have a job the next day to feed their children. And what they would like to bring to the forefront here is that self-censorship has long been one of the journalists' most inevitable hazards. And it says, in the real world of 2000, bypassing key issues of corporate dominance is apt to be a form of obedience. In effect, self-censorship, circus dogs jump when the trainer cracks the whip, Orwell observed more than a half century ago, you know, this behavior. He said, but the really well-trained dog is one that turns his somersault when there is no whip. Of course, no whips are visible in America's modern newsrooms and broadcasting studios. But if Orwell were alive today, he would surely urge us to be skeptical about all those somersaults, right? Okay. I've got a few things here that I'd like to cover too before we move on moving forward. This is your timeline. On January 2nd, just 1 week before the pretentious announcement, the head of Time Warner had alluded to the transcendent horizons. Global media will be, and is fast becoming, the predominant business of the 21st century, Gerald Levin said on CNN. And we're in a new economic age. And what may happen, assuming it's true, is it's more important than government. It's more important than educational institutions and nonprofits. Levin went on. So what's going to be necessary is that we're going to have these corporations redefined as instruments of public service because they have the resources. They have the reach, they have the skill base. And maybe there's a new generation coming up that wants to achieve meaning in that context and have an impact. And that may be a more efficient way to deal with society's problems than bureaucratic governments. Levin's next sentence underscored the sovereign right of the capital in dictating the new direction. And I quote, it's going to be forced anyhow, because when you have a system that is instantly available everywhere in the world immediately, then the old-fashioned regulatory system has to give way, he said. Such pledges, invariably uttered in benevolent tones, were bursts of fog. While Case and Levin moved ahead to gain more billions for themselves and maximum profits for some other incredibly wealthy people. By happy coincidence, they insisted,
the media course that would make them the richest was the same one that held the most fulfilling promises for everyone on the planet. Although, so like, let's talk about the New York Times for a minute in the book here. They, the Tribune Company, have a reputation not only for being a fierce cost cutter and union buster, but for putting greater and greater emphasis on entertainment and business. Right, see, we're just supposed to like be the observer and watch sports and go out and party and go out and eat and not pay any attention to what's going on in the world. But when you hear sirens all the time, wouldn't you think people would ask, what the fuck's going on? I do. Okay. I need to read page 25. Yeah, okay, I know what we're looking at here. So this merger was $37 billion. It was the largest in history, with potential effects on the broader public kept outside the story's frame. What emerged was a rosy picture. Analysts hailed the deal as a good fit between two complementary companies. The Associated Press reported flatly. The news service went on to quote a media analyst who proclaimed, "It's a good deal for everybody." Now, while countless reporters are determined to probe how each company stands to gain from the latest deal these days, few of them demonstrate more and much enthusiastic for exploring what is at stake for the public. This is why today I'd like to make an appeal to everyone watching that in any way you can, whether it's financial or getting involved in dialogue or liking or sending blessings or sharing Conscious Consumer Network with your spiritual family, please do. This is one of the few platforms where we really can expose how we got here. So God bless us all on our Independence Day today, right? Okay, now I know I promised you some fun, and it's all been kind of serious so far. But you know, I'm just getting started. We're only a half hour in. My little hair guys, you know, I got them right here. But I wanted to give you a story about how asleep some people are, or just how much they believe in advertising, okay? There's a alternative store here in the United States. It's known by the name of Spencer's Gifts. And when they were still open, and I guess they still are, I don't know. See the mall they were in? Yeah, the politicians built it in this floodplain. And they knew that they would make their money back within 5 years. And then from there, it could just, you know, fall to waste, right? So that would be the Mills Mall here in St. Louis, Missouri. That would be between the ghetto of North County, where I live, and across the river over into what they call the Promised Land now, which is St. Charles. But of course, they know that they're flying too. But if you want to fly, here's some new liquid marijuana that comes in a box. They sell it right at the store, even though it's illegal. Okay? And it says, your very own buzz in a bottle. All right. Catch the perfect buzz without catching the heat. Get high at work, in class, even at the pool. So discreet you can use it in front of your mom. And it says, it's like you're completely baked. Okay. I'm going to read you the back here real quick. The print is so small. This is new. From the laboratories of Jesus Had a Sister Productions, liquid marijuana, your very own buzz in a bottle. They've got the IL crossed out and it says it's completely legal. Stop waiting for your government to legalize marijuana. Stop waiting for your dealer to show up on time. Get high when you want, where you want, even naked in church. We only live once, right? So what are you waiting for? Time to get high. Thanks to Jesus, they had a sister productions helping you create your own reality since 1786. And this is the manufacturer's warning, so let's take this very seriously. As it says, this product contains absolutely no real marijuana or any other mind-altering substance. If you believed our preposterous claims, you must already be stoned. Are pretty incredibly optimistic. If you are unemployed, visit your local employment office. A unicorn training center may be hiring new riders. And you know, they've got a little thing you can fill out here to win 500 tons of high grade in a really baked potato. And we have a, what do you call it? When you endorse something. Okay. I used to spark up so often my house coat would catch fire. My husband complained the house smelled like an ashram with all the incense burning. I tried traditional marijuana patches, but I hated how they interrupted the lines of my Celtic tattoo. Your spray gets off my head without the headache of searching for rolling papers, getting busted or accidentally hotboxing the minivan full of kids on the way to school. And her name is Mary Jane, of course. And this only costs $6.95. So, you know, if you want to give somebody a funny joke or just mess with people, this is a good one. I hope you all enjoyed it. Okay, so have I got a lineup for you today? And I don't even really think I'm going to, like, bring it up before it starts. I thought about it because I thought that might keep you all around. But I promise you this, it's going to be fun, man. I totally hope that you guys enjoy my sense of humor. And I'll be doing the best I can because, of course, I love where I live. And I am a defender of this realm. That, you know, I'll bring little synchronicities in from my community of choice here, Ferguson, Missouri, and show you how these things play out in a global sense. And then it's possible that you might timeline what's going on in your neck of the woods, too. Okay. I got a story for you again. And so we're going back to the time of the purchase of this book. And this story involves the love of my life, And, you know, we had been really good friends for at least a decade when this book came out. And I remember, you know, him and I looking at it, and, you know, it kind of was pretty intense. One of his best friends, and I'll just use the name Kat. So if you ever watch this show, you know we love you, brother. But, you know, he was one of the first conspiracy dudes and running around trying to tell everybody. He is highly intelligent. I'm not even kidding you. But it drove him just bonkers that nobody would listen to him. And he's still out there trying to share with people. And sometimes he wants to give up. So I just wanted to say, don't ever, ever give up. Because sometimes when you life chart and timeline and you look and you say, wow, it took 20 years to complete this cycle, or it took 30. And it's all cool because in the end, this whole no time thing takes over and it's nothing to worry about. But my client and Joe's friend from growing up hung himself. You know, like that, the day before 9/11. And, you know, he kind of did it like as a na-na boo-boo. And I know that's really hard to understand, and I hope nobody takes offense, but, you know, he was too pretty to, like, hold a firework and blow up or something. You know, he did it naked, and, I mean, our brains were full. So the next day, we were all at the hair shop, and this was early in the morning when they announced the Twin Towers thing. And, you know, for the life of me, I don't know why I was at work so early, because I don't even like to work until 10 o'clock, at least in the morning. But I'm going to tell you, this was earlier than that, and I want to say 9:30. And watching that TV screen, you know what? We knew back then it didn't look real. But, of course, the trauma was so intense that, you know, whether it's what's getting programmed into your eyes or your ears, your mouth. I mean, shit. You know, if you think then, hey, I'm being lied to. Well, you know, that kind of takes the hope out of people at first. It takes the wind out of your sails. So now that we've seen this happen so many times, wouldn't you think that somebody could form an alliance and, you know, make all the proof into a nice little thing and life chart a timeline and do whatever and bring it to a screeching halt? Because as we all know, doing this shit the same way that it's been done would be insanity. And the definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over again, the same way, but expecting a different result. And that's why sometimes when I'm in my little goofy Sue's happy mood, you know, but I've got a point to get across, I love to call people stoners that I know do not imbibe marijuana. So, ha, 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 ha. Okay. Next up. And I'm already laughing just thinking about it. But, okay, so imagine I'm in my head right now, September 11th, you know, with the kaboom and the towers and the whole delusion going on. And it's 5 years before Joe and I come together, you know, as a twin flame couple that are here to carry out work and have a lot of fun. I have a video for you about my man. And I do want to say before I air this, it's seriously, Joe's badass. You don't want to mess with him. And he's the only person that I really know can take care of me. And it's because we're like this. And I'm kind of tough myself. So, hey, baby, let's go ahead and play this movie trailer that I learned how to make in iMovie. This was the message behind that video. My man Joe walks softly on this earth, but he carries a big ass stick, y'all, and is a conductor of power. So we are, yeah, he tries to be elusive, but you know, now we go into, I just want to tell you a little about what we did last weekend. Now, Joe's movie trailer fits into a global event, which we attended last weekend here in person. So here's the story on that. Our dear friend, Molly Rockman, that runs Earth Dance Organic Farms here in town, it was her 35th birthday, right? And she is a really such a wonderful woman on every level. And so she had the imagination arise in her to create a 3-day event that is all about her rebirthing in the earth. And so on Friday night, which is the footage that you guys saw, with Joe as my hero, that's from Friday night. It all started at the concert venue called 501 here in Ferguson. And this Miss Jubilee was playing and Molly danced this Wait Till You Meet Her. So we showed up there, and of course, when you're not necessarily one in a town like we are, they would really just wish you'd shut up. When we pull in the Jeep, everybody knows we're there. So the question was Joe's stick going to be a weapon? Would they consider it one? Would they tell him he couldn't bring his stick to an outdoor concert? We didn't know. And surely I was ready because I'm Susie Camera now. back to Molly, okay, because this really isn't about us. This is about touching people's hearts and minds. And so Molly is at this concert. She's dancing. She's got her family around her. I'm grabbing interviews with her mom and dad and people of the town that love her. And we go back to her farm for a fireside chat. That was Friday night. Now, on Saturday, they did a bike ride to the farmer's market. And they had some events in the day. I believe that she had a puppet show and she had tree climbing and, you know, just nice activities for people. And I was here at the Big Yellow House preparing for my show. I mean, I couldn't be there for the whole thing, but I collected over 5 hours of footage from last weekend. So I guess it's a good thing I couldn't be there all 3 days because there'd be way too many movies. When I rolled in after Sophia's Emporium, here's Molly doing this performance piece on her 35 years that I mentioned. But what I want to share with you guys, and of course, I was absolutely floored. Okay, here I am all into this life charting, and of course, I've had to expose these stories that are so hard for people. And you know, I do it colorfully with charts and pictures. But Molly, I mean, she exceeded what I've done by leaps and bounds and said less words than I have. So here it is. Her whole story of her life was song, dance, yoga, all this flow. And that's what Steiner knew of and defined as eurythmy. And so here we are out in nature in this very spiritual performance play, and that will be a 2-hour feature motion picture. I'm not even kidding you. On next week's show, I'm going to show you guys some movie shorts, like the trailer, like I did for Joe. I have a little more work to do before I share Molly with you guys. Okay, after the performance piece, Molly does something so amazing that's never been seen before. And people surely had some fears and some questions about it. So I give you a little short take on that. Our girl Molly, in her expression of her life and going through her triumphs and her tragedies, then, of course, you have the cycle of birth and death. She goes out in the field of her farm in an off-white silk outfit, by the way. And she lays down in the field. And people bless her and put some flowers on her. And then they start kicking up soil and putting it on her. So, of course, some people were tripping out saying, oh my God, what is that girl into? But, you know, interpretive, presentation is what clears past trauma. And I'll tell you this, when she came up out of that soil, all beautiful and dusty and free and natural, that was the start of a whole new expansion for my dear friend. And it was an honor that she allowed me to be there in her face, filming it, and make a movie without giving me any trouble. So I love you, Molly. Okay, Sunday morning. This wild woman has what's called farm church. And that is, of course, an alternative to worshiping inside of these places of energy exchange that maybe sometimes aren't on the up and up. You know, a lot of churches are built over other sacred sites, and that's the only reason I say that. The spirit world is very diverse, and it's hard to say all of the past karma and everybody's experience living here, the energy that is felt and dictates what we go through now. After Molly's farm church, there were two people who arose in love who chose to be earthed as well. So you're going to see a lot of dirty chicks out on a farm, but I'm telling you, it was super cool. All right. Next up, we're going to go into a little bit of news that's hot right now. And of course, it is just getting ready to happen. So we're going to go check out a little video on the 2016 Olympic Games in Rio. Go ahead and roll it, baby.
When you leave the international airport of Rio de Janeiro and head towards the south of the city, which is where all the beaches are, you pass a sprawling informal settlement called Mare. It's one of hundreds of neglected shanty towns like this in Rio. It goes on for miles. But when you pass by there today, all you see is this wall. Look at this map of Rio. Here's the part that you probably know. It's the south zone. It's where all the iconic beaches are. Mare is in Rio's north zone, which is where most of the city's poor live.
A barreira acústica, a ideia, segundo eles, era para poder barrar o som. Porém, é nítido que essa barreira, o único intuito dela é para quê? Para que as pessoas que saem do aeroporto do Galeão e vão sentido a zona sul não consigam ver a realidade da cidade.
They don't have sewage systems, they don't have housing rights, they don't have anything. But, you know, the city is really concerned about how loud the cars are because they're worried about, you know, the ears of the poor people that don't have food in their stomach.
The city just installed a big new school in this community a few months ago. You'll note that when we get to this part of the highway, the wall becomes totally transparent, giving us a perfect view of the shiny school.
Every time international attention comes to Rio, the city scrambles to build up infrastructure around tourism for visitors to see that it's this amazing city. The problem is the visitors will come and they go, but the people of Rio are here to stay. And they're frustrated. They're frustrated that their government will spend so much money to build up certain parts of the city and completely neglect others. The Olympics is no different in this case. In fact, it's probably the biggest excuse Rio has to pour tons of money into making the city look good.
This is Patricia. She rides the buses here in Rio and has noticed a major change in the bus routes recently.
It used to be a line who left Ramos, who is in the north zone, to Cosme Velho, where we had the Christ. And this line was extinguished.
Patricia is showing me a few examples of the 11 bus lines that were cut between the poor north zone and the touristy rich south zone, all in preparation for the Olympics. It's now much harder for a resident of the north zone to get down to the beaches of Ipanema or Copacabana. So why cut the bus line?
If all of these black people, poor people, barefoot people are there, it's like, no, we have to clean this. and they always wanted to clean, but now they have a purpose, they have a deadline to do this.
If discriminatory bus lines are bad, here's where it gets worse. So back to this map. Out here in the west is a place called Baja. R's are pronounced like H in Portuguese. This is a new part of the city where a lot of the Olympics action is happening. It's where the Olympics Park is going to be built. And because of this, it's home to what one real estate publication is calling a cosmopolitan awakening. Tons of real estate investment. And of course, a bunch of dramatic promotional videos to go with it. There's this one guy named Carlos Carvalho. He's a real estate developer, and he owns 64 million square feet in Baja. Last year, in a series of interviews with big publications, Carvalho sketched out his dream for Baja. His goal is to turn this place into a new Rio, a city for the elite, of good taste, noble housing, not housing for the poor. This guy's the 12th richest person in Brazil, and he's got a ton of political influence to make his dream happen. Here he is with Rio's mayor, whose re-election campaign he generously donated to. They're just, you know, looking over plans for how they're going to reshape Baja. But there's one big problem for people like Carlos Carvalho and his dream to make Baja a haven for the rich.
If your interest is in land value, the less poor people you have in your land, the greater value you can give it to it. They think of the city as a place for you to invest in, not a place for you to live in.
Over the years, little settlements of a few hundred families have popped up in Baja. It's usually workers unable to find affordable housing and creating communities of their own. These places have been around for decades, and many of them have gained legal status for their property. But to the luxury-minded developers of this new part of town, these informal settlements represent a barrier to their plan. So when the Olympic Park was planned for this area of Rio, it wasn't much of a surprise when the city came in with eminent domain eviction orders, telling these communities that they would be moved to public housing complexes, usually far out of sight of any international visitors. Most communities left, some happily taking the money that the city gave them. Some mounted intense but failed resistance. But I visited one community that didn't give up on the fight to keep their homes.
Quando falaram que as Olimpíadas iriam ser no Rio de Janeiro, nós já sabíamos que nosso problema ia aumentar.
Vila Autódromo was a community of around 600 families near where the Olympic Park is being built. It's not on the actual park property, but it's in the site of the park. This is what it looks like today.
People chose to go there because there was no drug trafficking or militia. It was very safe, very good sense of community, near jobs, near schools. It's hard to know that when you just visit the community. But you kind of get a sense of that by seeing the people who are still resisting, you know, because they're holding on to that memory and they want to keep some of that alive.
After years of fighting with the city hall, only 20 families of the original 600 remain in this community. Fierce protesting and a flurry of international press got the mayor to finally concede, saying that the 20 families could stay on condition that the city would build them nicer-looking homes, lest, heaven forbid, the international community catch a glimpse of the real Rio.
Tínhamos árvores frutíferas que nos alimentavam, que nós plantamos, não temos que quer fazer isso tudo novamente. Cada canto daquela casa foi construído com muito carinho, as árvores, as plantas.
O que impede a Vila Autódromo de permanecer do lado do Parque Olímpico? É alguma razão urbanística? Não, não é. É uma razão dos interesses econômicos que estão ligados à valorização imobiliária. Não tem outra razão.
Apesar de eu ter me preparado antes, eu sabia que um dia minha casa ia ter que ser demolida, mas para mim esse período foi o pior momento de toda a luta.
Through the long fight, some of Vila Autódromo was able to stay. But this is rare. Most communities that receive eviction orders no longer exist. At least 77,200 people have been removed from their homes in Rio de Janeiro since 2009. That's according to government data. And much of this is to make way for infrastructure and real estate projects associated with the World Cup and the Olympic Games.
So it's kind of a shame because the Olympics ends up coming in and kind of whitewashing areas and creating and reframing them. And, you know, you lose a lot of the personalities.
Of course, there have been numerous benefits to the people of Rio thanks to the Olympics investments. New bus lines, revitalizations of old parts of the city, museums, parks. This stuff will make life better in the city for sure. But in the end, billions of public dollars that were supposed to benefit the people ended up bowing to the interests of a few people with a lot of money. And instead of investing in the underserved, Rio will once again hide them from view.
Well, you know, mainstream media's job, of course, is to pump up the excitement for the Olympics, right? But watching that presentation and what they've done to those people that were not viable in their eyes, send them to what? Like camps? You know, send them off where nobody has seen them, because surely, you know, that's what cracks me up about people going on flipping vacations, because I don't go on vacations, all right? Is that they go somewhere where it's all beautiful and shit, but they can't leave the resort. They have walls up to hide the truth. See, I just can't buy into that kind of stuff. But it reminds me a lot of what I see here in St. Louis. All of North County has had its turn at being ravaged, stripped of community, turned into refugees. And of course, the next wave comes in, who they've intentionally set up to fail and not have any kind of hope. And then of course, they get blamed for what was set into place years ago. Here in St. Louis, and of course, you know, I've lived here my whole flipping life. You got the riverfront with the arch and all these huge buildings and skyscrapers. And, you know, of course, one stadium isn't enough even for a small cow town like the divided state of Missouri. So they build a brand new multi-gajillion dollar house for the football dudes. Okay, well, now they're not here. And you think, well, that's all right. Somebody else could use it. I mean, surely professional soccer or, you know, whatever it is that they're pushing, concerts or what other kind of events, you know, that they can make a buck on. And now this building sits vacant. And oh yeah, by the way, see, Missouri is a whole lot like Ferguson. We don't have the money, but we're gonna build some huge new stuff to bring people in, give them the illusion it's safe. And no matter how hard they try, people are a little afraid to come to St. Louis. They see the YouTubes about the ghettos and different things and what really goes on here. All I know is one thing, okay? My dad was a cop, and this is a police whistle. And I'm not gonna blow it loud because it like shatter your eardrums. I mean, this thing, is called the Acme Thunderer. And I believe it's made in Germany. I'm having a hard time reading it, but let me just look you up a little bit. That's nothing, okay? So I want to whistle blow just a little bit about what goes on, say, example here in St. Louis with the holiday weekend and the fireworks. Now, you got more people being pulled over down here for piss-ass stuff, but you never find anybody getting busted for shooting off fireworks where it's illegal. It's illegal in North County to shoot fireworks off, but everybody does it. I mean, it's as American as apple pie. You're supposed to like this shit, right? My biggest issue with it is that, you know, sometimes even myself can't distinguish the difference between a firework and a gunshot. And it doesn't matter which one it is. A firework could land on my house and set fire to, you know, our home. There could be all sorts of things, you know. Gunshots fly in houses all the time here in St. Louis. Well, why aren't these people ticketed or get in some trouble or do something? And of course, we know the reason is there is way too much money to be made on explosives. And I think explosives are almost a subliminal, you know, like a Pavlov's dog thing or something, where it gets you to like explosions and war and banging up stuff. I just am really not in. But, you know, like the bank wants to know, what am I doing this weekend? Sitting on my porch, man, watching the fireworks right across the street, camera in hand, and we'll see what happens on this street, because every year you want to talk about mayhem. So we'll bring that live. You know, I slow them down as they come 50 miles down a street that's supposed to be 25 miles an hour. I like to mess with people. Sometimes you can't even see me blowing it because I hide on the wraparound porch, you know. That's funny, isn't it? Okay. So, I got a funny video for you that isn't really funny, but in the end, it is pretty daggum funny. And this is like the very bad things that can happen if you play with fireworks. So, enjoy.
Yeah, we're recording.
It's on, good?
It's on.
Okay. So, something like this. I'm not sure what it's called. Got from Ohio. Do you think this thing is a flying spark? Yeah, it's good.
No, it came with a manual. It said that it was just gonna explode. I don't think it's gonna. I think the arrows are just like a thing.
Like face the side up. Probably.
Sure, we'll go with that.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like it.
I think it's just gonna explode. All right. Well, let's do this. I'm not lighting it.
Why not?
Guys, I'm not lighting that thing.
No one has all the faith in the world
with
this thing.
I don't care. I'm not lighting. I bought it, you might as well.
That's fair. No, I'm not lighting it. I'm the cameraman.
Oh, my God. All
right. He bought it, you light it. It's fair.
I'll see you on Twitter, whatever. Get in there.
It's not going to bite you.
Listen, this thing's huge. I don't want this thing blowing up on me. It doesn't matter how slow you like it. All right, fine. Right. Let's pull it out.
I don't think you have to be that far back. Seriously, it's probably like a sparkler.
I don't care. Look at that. Yeah, it's not going to be a sparkler. That thing's going. It's like a shack of firecrackers.
Shouldn't it have gone off? It's not burning anymore. Well, what's that going to do? It's not going to make it light. Just, well, the camera's not a shield. I'm not going to walk up to it. If it was going to blow up, it would have blown up by now. Just grab the stupid thing.
The stick's doing nothing. The fuse is gone.
See, it's fine. Just pick it up. Just pick it up. Don't make me come out there and pick it up. Oh, yeah. Fine. Aim it at me. Thanks, man. I'm sure it's fine. Just pick it up. See, there's nothing. Oh, my God! Oh, man, I think I'm going to be sick. Oh, I think I'm going to be sick.
Kaboom, right? But didn't they do a good job? Like, making that look real. So here again, it just goes to show that somebody had believed something. I don't know. I just thought it was funny shit. So let me hit you with the punchline of why I really like that. So here's these two dopes, you know, doing their thing. And of course, the one dope gets blown up and all that's left is his ankles and his feet, right? Okay, and there's blood all over the camera. Now, can you imagine? Here you are in Rio, saying life's a beach, hanging out, and all of a sudden, you start seeing those feet and ankles wash up on the beach. I don't know if you guys heard about that. There was 12 feet and ankles washed up on the beach. I thought I was just connecting things for you. It's funny how foreshadowing can lead to a really important message. Am I going to watch the Olympics, you ask? All right. Oh, am I going to buy a t-shirt? No. Okay. Am I going to give it any effort, any energy? Hell no. That's my take on that corporate mob. Okay. You know, one of my favorite shows, as you guys know, is Rocky Horror Picture Show. I went over 100 times, you know, when I was in high school and blah, blah, blah. St. Louis was the second city to show Rocky Horror Picture Show. It came out in 1975. And we had it by 1978. I became a freshman in 1979. So you know where I spent my high school years. Where else could you party till 2 in the morning and be safe and have fun? The thing that I want to bring in, though, is this whole aspect of, like, time warping. And I thought I'd give you a little bit of dance action to get you ready for upcoming shows with all the videos and the dancing and the fun and the community. This is a bunch of college kids, so I hope you enjoy it. It's time warp.
Feels astounding, time is beating, madness takes its toll, but listen closely, let my nervous longer, I've got to keep control.
And now that you're in another dimension, let's look back at all these mysterious deaths over the years that nobody could explain. And, you know, it was early on when I started my YouTube channel that I spoke out about the slaying of Mike Brown here in Ferguson, Missouri. And exposed, you know, the concept that most people understand, surely, that there are these devices on the top of the military trucks that put out these pulses and tones and different things. And of course, they can irritate people and make them angry and fight each other. So it's not too far-fetched to say that, just like we learned in previous videos, let's say that you have a piece of metal in you that maybe part of you has been rebuilt or has a pacemaker or, you know, just whatever new modern contraption they want to strap onto the human, right? Well, believe it or not, guys, and this is truth at its finest. For years, these SOBs have had a gun, okay, and it doesn't shoot bullets. It shoots this icy thing. And so they get close up, you know, to somebody and shoot it in their heart, and it melts inside and gives the person a heart attack and doesn't leave any marks. So, you know, when you're out there talking with your friends and they say you're full of shit, just show them this. So, CIA whistleblower talks about the heart attack gun. Let's rock and roll.
Then I went to technical services where I was in charge of finding documents that you don't find in libraries, like like where you put explosives on a bridge, where's the best place to put an explosive on a bridge, and what kind of explosive do you have to get that goes underwater without it, you know, destroying its effectiveness. Also, I had to find, one time they wanted me to find out if there was such a thing as a poison that was undetectable, especially one that seemed to mimic a heart attack, that would kill someone, but it would appear that they had a heart attack. I did find such a thing.
Does this pistol fire the dart?
Yes, it does, Mr. Chairman, and a special one was developed which potentially would be able to enter the target without perception.
The poison was frozen into some sort of dart, and then it was shot at very high speed into the person, so when it reached the person, it would melt inside them, and the only thing would be like one little tiny red dot on their body, which was hard to detect. There wouldn't be a needle left or anything like that in the person.
But also the toxin itself would not appear in the autopsy?
Yes, so that there was no way of perceiving that the target was him.
I think the first time that I seriously questioned anything, that was more than, I just couldn't take it anymore, was when I came across this document. It was eyes only. It was to my boss, but he only had one hand and a hook in the other hand, so I always opened all of his mail, his packages and so forth. And this one, he wasn't in the office. I opened it and I read it. It said eyes only. I wanted to read it because I wasn't supposed to, probably. And it was a report about a mission where they had blown up a bridge in Asia somewhere, and they had killed a number of women and children who were on their way to market that morning. It was reported as though they were really proud, mission accomplished. That one bothered me a lot. When my boss came in, I gave him his mail, and I mentioned this, and I said, this is wrong. These women hadn't done anything. These children didn't deserve to die. Why did we do that? And he said, that's the fortunes of war. And I said, but we're not at war. We're certainly not at war in that country. Why did we do that? I don't understand it. And he said, well, you're very young. When you get older, you'll understand those things.
Now that's pretty cold, isn't it? That someone could do that to another human and just leave this little tiny red dot as evidence. And I'll tell you what, if you're a girl like me with freckles, they'd never see it, would they? Okay, now there was a video that I thought about playing for you guys and then I just said no, kind of like, you know, crack or heroin. I just said, nah, I don't want to lose anybody on this, but I do want to share it to you and I want to soften it up and bring it as sweet as I can. Okay. And you know, another thing before I even go there. All right. So Randy Moggins and Emily Moyer had a great show just recently. And Emily brought up something that Randy speaks of often, which is, okay, like let's say you got a piece of news coming out of somewhere that you automatically can't say this or that. You have to be able to discern that grain of truth in there, even though the organization that may be bringing it forward has been found in the past to not necessarily be as up and up as we would like. We have to be able to filter this information. So this is one of those videos, and I didn't know how you guys would react to it, but if you'd like to watch it for yourself, there's a guy by the name of Bill Maher, M-A-H-E-R. A lot of people in the States know him. He's on HBO. And then, that's cable. And then, of course, you also had him on Late Night Mainstream. which he's a little racy for, but I really liked his last show because it was called America's Apology, and it was dated June 24th. So since I really do love Mother Earth and life and, you know, where I'm born and all those good things, I liked it that he came up with a bunch of things that we should maybe say we're sorry for. And so I'm gonna say sorry for it in my own way. So this video starts out, you know, blah, 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 and about how, you know, Obama's going on an apology tour. And he says, but you know, y'all aren't really gonna like this. And then of course they show him in a red turban, you know. And it goes on to talk about, you know, I don't even really like to talk about politics, but you know, Mr. Trump. And they say, you know, as a slogan, we're back on our meds, America's on their meds. Well, I'm gonna tell you what, this girl right here is not on any meds, nor has she ever been, nor will she ever be. I am totally homeopathic and holistic, and I don't want what they're pushing. You know, they compared what we're going through to like your last, you know, a few months of senior year in high school. Then I thought I'd bring you a funny story from my life about high school. And, you know, this is childish and trivial, okay, but this is the truth as far as targeting and blacklisting goes. So imagine this. You got three girls in a bathroom. One's your buddy Sue's in a cheerleading outfit. The other is a girl that nobody knows, is dating a high school teacher at a parochial school. And the other one's a good girl that is engaged. We're seniors by now, but freshman year, I hooked her up with this senior, and the next thing you know, I mean, she got married right out of high school. So we're all in a sports uniform. The other girls played field hockey. Okay. We're in the bathroom. We're going to have a cigarette, right? So they both got their cigarettes lit. And my dumb ass doesn't have a lighter yet. So I'm waiting to light mine, right? And all of a sudden, this big dykey teacher bolts into the bathroom. And she says, Glasscock. And you know, that was my name. You know, to the office. Okay. Now, I didn't even have a lit cigarette, but you know, I'm in the shit house, right? And the other girls, nothing happened to them. But this was so traumatizing to your friend Sue's here. Because my punishment, if you can believe this, was getting put last place on homecoming court and getting kicked off cheerleading. And, you know, here again, I'm just the bottom of the barrel, right? So here's what I did. I checked how many days that you could skip school. And the answer was 49. And so I took it down to 48 and a half when I graduated, because you know what? I was so sick, 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 sick of putting up with the box that I just had to jump right out of it. So that's my little story as far as I'm sorry. You know what? I'm not sorry that I've made any of the choices I've made. I am sorry that I didn't speak louder at the time, you know, because of course it really did affect me in my little life, you know, as a child. So There's some more humor for you. But back to this apology tour, okay? He says that we should say sorry to the Indians, which I absolutely agree with. We should say sorry to the Japanese people that were put in internment camps here. Absolutely. We should say sorry to the people that were victims of the Tuskegee experiments, which I know is an easy way to term all the undercover shit that was done to people, their health, their minds, body, spirit, the whole nine yards. Tragedy. Oh, it's not tragedy, it's trading. They crack a joke about, you know, okay, we made slavery illegal, but where else can you trade two people as long as you have a draft pick? Yeah, we should say sorry to the people that are poured out like that too, I agree. They say that America has acted like a nasty drunk, and that we should do what they teach you in AA, which is go say sorry to everybody that you offended. They mention a show that we used to watch all the time called My Name is Earl. And if you've ever seen that, he's working through some rotten karma and he's trying to be a good person every day of his life. And he gets confronted with a plethora of touching situations, whether they be funny or not. They also bring up that we should say sorry to putting these people in power that ran companies like, or countries like Vietnam, Mexico, and they said that we should say sorry to our booty call, which is is Iran, and we didn't mean to screw you, but man, we were addicted to the oil. We couldn't even help ourselves. It made it real easy, greasy kind of thing. Here again, sorry to Guatemala, to the Congo, to the Dominican Republic, to Brazil, and to Chile. And you know what we did there is that, you know, we supported these dirty dictators because we were afraid of Stalin. And they also, and this is just a joke, but like the good recovery alcoholics, you know, that they're making fun of, right? Yeah, us Americans drunk on power. We want to offer if we could love somebody up for you. But then he says, no, 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 no. That's that old masculine chauvinistic kind of thing that maybe the guy with the hair, you know, is issuing out. And this is all in regard to what they call America's inner asshole, which may be something like a really naughty inner child. So, Lord forgive us for we didn't know what we were doing. It's time to quit blaming ourselves. It wasn't us, the individual. It was the power that governed over us that influenced our beliefs. So let's jump out of this and take care of business, right? I'm gonna close the show up today with some hot gossip from right here in Ferguson, Missouri. And let's just talk about this. And I have a story to share. So this is a post that my friend, let me turn that light, shared with his group, and he's very much the activist. And it's funny, when I first came to town and we lived in the building that wasn't suitable for occupancy, I know you remember I've told you, a lot of people were curious to who this crazy redhead was with the hippie boyfriend that really thought they could turn that building around because we must be stoned or something, right? So this guy actually and his buddy, which is my friend Robert Knapop that I talk about, you know, the referee that's here to discern between the dark and the light, they actually both live here on the same street with me. So we're brothers in arms and sisters in crime or something, you know. But anyhow, what he shared when I first saw it, it took about 5 minutes, okay? And then I said to myself, I mean, really? Could they be making this new ordinance just because I'm a journalist now that is broadcasting in 144 countries or 140, I never know which one it exactly is, but I'll never forget after today, right? So anyhow, my town of Ferguson here has created a new ordinance. Now let me just kind of kick it up here to the screen so you can see that it is a real document and that you can find it online. To where now, they're saying, hey, y'all, you can't tape a city council meeting, you can't film a city council meeting, and if you do, you're going to get arrested. So, something I think that is humorous about this is I go through my crucifixion here. It's funny, they've continually made ordinances that it's almost like they're custom designed for me. Now, if I would have said that 20 years ago, people would have said, Suze, you're stoned. Suze, you're paranoid. Suze, you're wrong. Suze, you're arrogant. You don't mean nothing. Oh, okay. So when I first came here, I wasn't here more than a year before they changed the ordinances about hair shops. And through this whole thing, say of even me getting harassed every month with these unsigned letters. And even if we go back to what can we do to improve the community when we got to write on the little postcard, the first thing we need to quit doing is allowing people to be harassed on what they consider to be an anonymous complaint. There's no such thing. What that actually means is the person that is complained about is not allowed to know who their accuser is. Now that surely fits in with the world oligarchy today, doesn't it? So, you know, my suggestion, and of course this isn't mine, I didn't dream up it up, this is a moral ethical thing that is recorded time and time in history. If your neighbor has a complaint with you, then they should come one-to-one, face-to-face, heart-to-heart, and take care of it. They've been terrified since I've been talking down here, and they keep trying to create these little things like the one I showed you, Ferguson Fact Check, which was a page, you know, to speak your mind instead of just talking to anybody, that you could come here. And I did a show about that, and you remember, even though I was typing things in, nobody was talking back. And of course, I knew I had been duped, and I quit talking. I mean, everything I said was reputable and honest. Feel free to go there, Ferguson fact check. And you will see that that website has been inactive for months now. It was all bullshit from the go. So, now we got this ordinance. No taping. We can call secret meetings. We don't even have to disclose what happened. Say it to the hand, right? I know they're trying to crack down. We see it everywhere. We know what time it is. We know what's up. And I'm telling you, as much as, you know, I say, how about support CNN, CCN, or say support Earth Dance Organic Farms, I have to really humble myself and ask you guys to please support me and what's going on here in this city, because I'm taking incredible risks. And it's okay. I knew I had one good fight left in me, right? But if you guys can make sure to follow this story of what plays out here in Ferguson, especially over the next 6 weeks as we roll into that cycle of time and the cell memory of the lies and the death and the destruction and the insidious way to set up military takeover. Man, we're all gonna get called to action. Now, prepare in whatever way it is, even if it's just preparing your heart. I have nothing to say on how to delegate authority. You know that in your own being. All right. So I want to read, well, actually I want to tell a story, another story from Sue's world. This town loves parades, and I mean, they're cute, you know, I like a good parade, right? So last year, our 4th of July celebration, in order to help the people of this community, here's what they did. All right, this thing's held at Wabash Park, which is actually a natural spring. I live here on Cutoff Indian Mounds, okay? So, at this park, they set up a soap box, if you can believe that. And here's what a soap box meant. Now, don't ask me if I went, because you know I didn't. It was easy enough to watch the media feeds and to get it from firsthand people that were there. Anyhow, they, you know, they had a caution tape, like when somebody gets killed, you know, caution, do not enter, right? They made a square with caution tape. And around it, you know, people in uniforms were hanging out. I'm sure it was intimidating. And of course, the elite were very, very close by. And, you know, you could go within that box on that day and say whatever you wanted from inside the taped off area. And of course, that did really not make the community very happy. And, you know, it also brought a question up to community, which is, don't we have the right of free speech when we're standing outside in God's country? The answer was no, my friends, in their world. So, what a joke. All right. I did a show on hagiography, which would be the whitewashing of history and how that's happened here in Ferguson. But I just wanted to read you a little from our mayor. And please remember, I'm going to assume until it's been proven wrong that there is someone way higher than this man putting the words in his mouth. So, we are the city. There is no us and them. I know it's hard for many people to accept this fact, but 100% of what the city government does on a daily basis is to serve you, the citizen. Every rule, every law, every process goes to serve a public purpose that tries to serve the community as a whole. Sometimes when you are the one that an inspector visits or that the police officer pulls over, it feels like it's a you versus them. But really it is about serving and protecting our collective interest or safety. Every action the city takes is meant to serve a greater purpose in this community, one that each and every one of us individually benefit from. Now wait, if there's even one person, kind of like that White Crow story, I'm your girl. Because nothing has been orchestrated here to benefit me. And I've lived here 9 years. So I don't agree with the statement, obviously. All right. Next month, the citizens of our community will have to make a choice. You know, we already had a tax increase pushed through that nobody wanted, and you know, there's no jobs and people are losing their homes, but hey, you need a tax increase so we can take care of your dumbass. All right. The choice is whether we will live with this new reduced level of public safety services provided by the city, or will we be willing to pay additional taxes to put officers back on the street and keep the doors open to firehouse number two. See, even though they got their one in tax increase, they didn't get two. And see, the second one was gonna, you know, keep things safe for people. And the other one was all about the schools, which for anybody that knows, if you live here and you're right, no matter what color you are, you put your kid in a private school. So let's not pretend that all this money is going to help the Ferguson Forest and School District, because I'm going to have to tell you, you're stoned. All right. Well, no one wants to pay additional taxes. The truth is that no one will want to accept the consequences of not paying the additional taxes. Like, our consequences can get any worse. Y'all, we live down the street from a nuclear dump. They're spraying shit over our heads. You tell me how it's going to get better with a little bit of money that isn't even real. The consequences, will be increased call time for all of our, you know, police, fire, and ambulance in the community. We're already overworked and struggling and having a hard way to go and so on and so forth. So, the Ferguson City Council has placed on the ballot another tax increase. This time a utility tax increase of 2%. Oh, shit. You know, I still got a question, okay? So, here we are forced by law to pay the same trash service that takes all the stuff to the nuclear dump. I mean, they're not even moral and ethical, are they? But we're paying them like the mafia or something. I mean, they're way deep in the shit, aren't they? See, that was funny. That was another one of my jokes. Okay. 2%, it's very important. Oh yeah, by the way, we got the ballots fixed too, so don't worry about that. It'd be about, what, 52.1 to 47.9? I mean, you know, you can set the dial. We've seen that video too. All right, that's enough of that. Let's mosey on down the road. It is a very nice paper. And Here's what I'm going to leave off with today. You know, a lot of people are amazed and stupefied, actually, that there are people that actually run this town that don't hold office. And when we first came here, okay, I'm going to show you a picture, and I want to tell you a story real quick. All my son wanted to do was play baseball. And, of course, it was a private school team. And, you know, they allowed him to play at first. But this one day when we were at the park, the gal in the picture here was talking shit on one of the other moms, and Joe busted her. And when the gal looked at this gal and says, "Are you talking about me?" Joe took his little pointer and said, "She's talking shit on you." And so, you know, the next thing you know, sweet Ian wasn't playing ball. But I have some of that, you too. And I know, of course, come Monday, just like every year, they'll walk up the street because you see they live at the bottom of the hill. But they're the same people that call the top of the hill where we live Lower Royal. See, that's a joke, because the hierarchy lives at the top of the next hill. So, you know, whoever, whatever, whatever. All I can say is I sure do hope that we get rescued out of this soon. I hope the cavalry's on its way, and I hope we're all singing and holding hands and stepping out of this, because it's tired and it's done. So let me finish up with this. Even in our most casual moments, we pulse in synchronicity. And every word we use carries within it the experience of generation after generation of men, women, families, tribes, and nations, often including their insights, value judgments, ignorance, and spiritual beliefs. I really appreciate you guys hanging out for another show with me. And as you can see, all my male friends with their unique hairstyles are telling me it's time to wrap it up. I hope everybody has a safe weekend. And if you can, don't participate in the purchase of anything from these corporate assholes.
All right, let's stop that share. And, you know, I always enjoy seeing my shows and then timelining the progression of what's happened since then. So this is back in July, right? Now, it is common knowledge now, friends, that George Soros funded the chaos here in Ferguson, Missouri. And, you know, I've lived in North County my whole life, and the people that are here are strong, diverse, and caring. And it was very obvious to the people that were working with their heart brains that the folks that came in and set fire right by the Hair Emporium and at the Little Caesars, which is my next door neighbor, at exactly the same time. So I have some of that for an update as well. One of the main points of today was to provide the timeline of how media was stomped out along the way, just like many fine things. And there's no judgment. But let's all remember, too, that that's what is at stake now. with truth and the chaos that it has erupted with everyone knowing that the same Soros funds that control mainstream media control alternative media. And the very people that did me dirty are paid by those people. And I've been threatened. So that's why we're rebroadcasting via Zoom. You guys, there's always something you can do to protect yourself. And when you stand with the six heart virtues, you'll be fine. Have a wonderful day. I'll talk soon.